Before all hell broke loose and darkness swept over the earth, Jesus and his closest disciples came to stay in Bethany, my hometown, which is just east of Jerusalem. It was a great act of courage that he came. You see, he had been warned to stay away from Jerusalem. Jesus, he was like a big lump of bread stuck in Herod's throat. And Herod, that snake, meant to swallow him whole. We all knew as much. But Jesus, he would never save his own skin. The life Jesus offered was bigger than himself, bigger than his own earthly life. Also, to be clear, he had done nothing wrong. He had done nothing but point to God at work in our midst. He had done nothing but heal the sick. He had done nothing but give encouragement to the poor and to the brokenhearted. He had done nothing but love us. For this, he was supposed to run away from Jerusalem and hide? Not my Jesus. So he came to stay in Bethany, where he had many friends, and where he easily made himself at home. He had become a brother to us, and a teacher, even a friend. I knew Jesus was not long for this world. I sensed that his time had come. You see, to be honest, for most people in this world, he was too good, too honest, too loving, too demanding. Some viewed him as a threat, but to those who had eyes to see, he was the light of the world, the light that cannot be darkened. He was, for those who had eyes to see, he was like a river of living water, the kind of water that quenches the thirst of all who seek truth. And for those who had eyes to see, he was the bread of life that nourishes hungry souls. When I think of him now, I see Jesus more simply as the love of God. It is a love that will not let you go. It is a love that sees straight into a person's heart. It is a love that sees the best in others, a love that cannot pass by on the other side of suffering, a love that lifted Lazarus, who was also from Bethany, right out of the grave. It is a love that bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. It is a love that claims its own name, agape. What happened that day, the day I poured a pound of precious perfume all over Jesus' head and weary feet, is that I was overcome by that agape love. I had carefully saved this very expensive perfume. It is the kind sometimes used to prepare the dead for burial. It was perfume, for instance, that I might have spent on Lazarus, but joyfully did not have to. Then it became perfume I might have used to anoint Jesus in death. However, I could not stand the thought of spending this fragrance in death, and I wanted Jesus to know while he was alive how deep, how extravagant was my love. So often do we withhold words of love, acts of love, until a person has departed this earth. Is that not true? Too often we are miserly with our earthly affections. And to what end? I wanted Jesus to know right then and right there how much I loved him, how grateful I was for him, to him. And I did not simply want to say it, I wanted to show it. It was an impulsive decision, and that is perhaps too often my way. I realized the whole event was unbecoming. Women are not supposed to let their hair down in public, let alone use their hair to anoint feet. I knew I was making a spectacle of myself, but sometimes in this life, we have to set aside embarrassment in order to love the way God calls us to love. Jesus, well, he seemed to understand my gesture with appreciation and grace. What I did would have been, I think, a humble expression of the love of which I speak this morning, except for Judas. Judas and some of the other disciples. Judas openly condemned my behavior. Judas, as you may know, was always concerned about what? Money. And I know I should not speak ill of him. Jesus, as I mentioned, taught me to see the best in others. But Judas was such a troubled, grasping man, and he sought to humiliate me that day. Here I was pouring myself out to Jesus, and Judas asked rudely, loudly enough for all to hear, "Why was this perfume not sold for 300 denarii and the money given to the poor?" In that moment, his was the voice of judgment, the voice of rejection. All eyes were on me, embarrassed mess that I was. And Judas had daggers in his eyes. His question was an attack. Now, it did not matter to me that my dignity was assaulted, denounced, but I did care that he called into question my compassion, my sense of judgment. His question made it sound as if I did not care about the poor, and that is simply not true. I felt, nevertheless, awful in that moment about what I had done. Judas made me wonder why I had saved that perfume, why I had not sold it so that the hungry might have bread. Judas made me feel self-indulgent, and that was the very opposite of my intention, the very opposite. Jesus, God bless him, was quick to respond. He said, "Leave her alone. Let her keep what she has for my burial. You will always have the poor, but you will not always have me." Jesus' words were a reminder that his time on earth was quickly nearing an end. His words certainly put Judas in his place. Again, I should not look down on anyone, but Judas, that conniving complainer, he needed to be put in his place. And for me, Jesus' words affirmed the love I was trying to show, however awkwardly, however inadequately. I am a lowly woman, and there is not much I can do on this earth. Jesus said, however, that what I did that day would be remembered, and that I would be remembered for doing it. Years have come and gone, and I think very few people remember me or what I did. Some said that it was a waste. What I did was a waste. But is there any act of love that is a waste? Is there any act of love that is too extravagant? Perhaps. As I have already confessed, my intent was never to be wasteful. It was to honor Jesus, who has been so good to me, so good to all of us. He brought so many gifts into this world, gifts of healing, gifts of acceptance, gifts of love. No one has ever made me feel so worthwhile, so valuable. You may not be as aware of this fact as am I, But Jesus treated women as real human beings, not simply as children or servants, as other men did. He got into trouble for it, too, all the time. The disciples couldn't imagine why he spent so much time in conversation with women. But I think I know the answer. I think it was because his love knew no bounds. His love was not about male and female, rich and poor. It was beyond all that. Love is the very heart of Jesus' message. Do not forget that. When you are trying to figure out what to do in any given situation or how to behave, bow to the love God offers, the love Jesus taught and lived. When you are struggling to find the path that is most just, most right, ask yourself, what is the path most loving? Anoint your lives with the perfume of that love. Be the fragrance of that love. Share it, give it, receive it. Make it the very heart of your life. That may sound simplistic, like the words of someone who is naive. But when you think of the people of this world, when you think of the greed, the cruelty, the rancor, love is hard labor. It is not some nice idea. It is difficult work. But it is the work of Jesus, now called the Christ. It is the meaning and the message of his life. It is the meaning and the message of his death. And it is the highest calling to which we are called. I commend this work of love to you, whatever the cost.